considerations. And then I'm going to summarize the whole thing. So sexual health is something WHO defines as integration of somatic, emotional, intellectual, and social aspects in ways which are positively enriching to a person's personality. The optimum female sexual health comprises of the, hang on, I'm a little unfamiliar with this computer. Okay. Let me not get into the definition part of it. Sexual dysfunction in women is extremely complex and is highly prevalent. And definitely it reduces the quality of life of a woman if she is suffering from any kind of dysfunction. And talking about sexual issues is such a taboo in our country that women usually would not talk about these issues unless they are probed. And usually we would see in our OPDs that they come with totally different issues. You have to kind of get a history out of them that what is it that they are suffering from. Sexuality is extremely culture dependent. It is your experience and expression of your thoughts, your fantasies, your beliefs, your attitude, your values, so many things. We are a person because of our experiences, and it includes all these dimensions, but all these dimensions are not always experienced or expressed in a woman at the same time. I will leave this for a little later. I think we will come to the clinical part of it, like sexuality education depends on your physical expression, your relationships, your culture, your social identity. It is like, you know, a woman in India would behave differently to something like, say, a demand for, say, oral sex, vis-a-vis to somebody in America who would react differently to a demand like that. So, you know, a socio-cultural issue is extremely important when sexual issues are concerned. So the idea of telling you all these is you have to talk to a woman in a culturally appropriate environment. Something that she considers very outrageous, she would just inhibit herself and she would not open up to you. So coming to a sexual dysfunction, traditionally, we have had 5 classifications. This is what the psychology students were taught. The first was a hyposexual sexual desire. That meant that the woman had less interest in sexual activity. Almost all men would complain that their women have less sexual interest. So, but it doesn't mean that all women were suffering from HSDD. We talked about last time of a desire discrepancy wherein a man and a woman have different desires for intimacy, and the frequency of sexual encounters have to be taken into account that both might be normal, but they just have a desire discrepancy. Now we would talk about precise definitions of each and how do we go about it. So first was a hyposexual desire disorder. Then is a sexual aversion, wherein a woman definitely wants to avoid all sexual activity. Then almost 20% women also suffer from sexual arousal disorder, wherein she has difficulty in maintaining vaginal lubrication till the sexual act is complete, despite adequate physical stimulation. So she gets dry in the middle of a sexual act, she gets pain, she gets a burning sensation without any obvious STIs or anything, or without having any problems and despite having adequate physical stimulation. Then almost 1/3 of women also suffer from orgasmic disorder, which might vary from poor quality of orgasms to total anorgasmia. And this is definitely more common in women than men. And the last category is a painful sex disorders like vaginismus, wherein the woman has such strong painful spasms, which doesn't allow any penetration to happen. And it also includes other miscellaneous causes of painful sex. So these were traditionally the five classifications of female sexual dysfunction. Thankfully, our lives have been made easy in the new classification. So female sexual dysfunction, according to the new DSM criteria, is now three. Earlier, we had five classifications, and now we have the three classifications, wherein we have the first one, the hypoactive desire dysfunction and the arousal dysfunction have been merged into female sexual interest and arousal disorder. So we have one wherein the woman has less interest and can't be aroused. So that is one category. Second is a pain disorder, wherein there is a genitopelvic pain and penetration disorders, which is like vaginismus and other causes of dyspareunia. And the orgasmic disorder stays the same. So it's easy. Either the person has a problem with sexual interest and arousal, or she has pain, or she has difficulty getting good orgasms. So these are the three categories that now we will be dealing the sexual dysfunction in. Female sexual dysfunction affects almost 50% of women at any given time, and it may disrupt her personal life. And studies have been conducted where it says that distress increases once a woman is reached adulthood, and it peaks around the time when she achieves menopause. Like we talked about the categories, obviously dysfunction may take, patient may come to you that she doesn't feel like having sex. She might say that everything is okay. She feels very dry. She has no lubrication despite having enough estrogens in her blood works. Then she might say, I have not been, earlier I was having orgasms and now I cannot have orgasms. Or it can be a combination of all these things which might be resulting into a painful intercourse. Now, as a clinician, how do we diagnose female sexual dysfunction? One, you need to have a suspicion. B, history. And three, examination. These are the three things, like we go about any other thing, we go about a sexual issue also. Why I have written suspicion is because women, these days, of course, women have become very proactive about and vocal about their issues. But some women still would come to you that they want a baby. Actually, it is that they have never consummated their marriages, or they have had painful sexual encounters, or they have had bad sexual, they've heard bad things from their friends or something. So they would really never be forthcoming with what is it that they are looking at. So you need to suspect, on a couple who comes to you, and really ask questions in a culturally appropriate language. And then is the history. We need to make a small questionnaire ourselves, depending on where we are practicing, in the local language works best. Like I'm in Delhi, most of my patients speak English and they are coming from well-to-do backgrounds, and most of them are very aware about anatomical terms also. But what a normal questionnaire can look like is a very simple question like, are you happy with yours and your husband's sexual life? Yes or no? If she's yes, obviously she doesn't belong to the category that we are discussing. If the answer is no, let her continue and take the rest of the questions. How long she has been dissatisfied with the current relationship? What is her perception of the problem? Why is she not having a good sexual function? Is it that she has no interest, or the partner has no interest? Is that she feels decreased sensation? Is that she feels decreased vaginal lubrication? Does she have problems reaching climax? Is she having any other issues or painful sex? And she could be having all of them together. People who are totally close to sex as an activity would have problems with all aspects. So you might ask her to even rank what is her problem that she feels is the greatest in her mind. That's fine. Physically, you might have a different findings, but this is what she feels like. What is most pertinent to them as a couple? And then, does she want to talk about it with you? Yes or no? So these are the samples.